Today is Thursday, July 27, 2021. My name is Mark Armenia, and I am documenting Shang-Yi Hua, her oral history, via an interview over Zoom for the Houston Asian American Archive. So, starting from the very beginning, where and when were you born?
I was born in Taiwan, the city is Hsinchu, and I was born in 1967.
And then can you describe what it was like growing up there? Like walk us through the neighborhood that you grew up in and the memories you have associated with it.
Oh, I was born in Hsinchu, but I moved to Taipei when I was 3 or 4 years old. And the memory in Hsinchu is blurry. I don't have too much memory in Hsinchu, but once I moved in Taipei, because it's all apartment in Taipei, and I looked through the window and I felt I was in the jail. It's because in Hsinchu, where we live is very open. I can run around with our neighbor. I think that's why I felt I was in a jail. It's like in a, you cannot just walk out the door and there's grass like here, but in Taipei, it's a city. Yeah, so for me, at that time, I remember I just looked through the window and I had a lot of imaginations in my little head. Yeah, and that's very, the memories, they are very vivid. Yeah, so I always lay on the sofa and look the ceiling to imagine there was another space over there. So I think that helped me later when I create my art. Yeah.
Yeah. Quite mm-hmm. the imagination as a kid.
Yeah. But the system, the education you mentioned, about the environment, how I lived, because the education system in Taiwan is very different from here, especially in my generation. Yeah, we obey everything that we just listen, we just accept. So the thinking process is different from here. Yeah, and it's like, yeah, all we could do is obey. And I never thought about, I never dreamed about I could be an artist in the future, because the background is like, in my generation, it's like a trend. And it's like all the girls, most of the girls, you should go to business, literary history, something like this. Most of the boys goes to the like science, that side. So it's like, it's kind of like a set, and just a few girls go to the other side. Yeah, so it's weird. And and I think it's a Chinese culture. Everything is not good except study. It's a phrase. Yeah, it's a barrier for us in my generation. Yeah, because my parents were born in China and they moved to Taiwan at 1949. And that's why I felt the form I'm a Chinese born in Taiwan. Yeah, that also make me feel kind of like lost, because especially when I grew up, especially when I moved to here, when I went back to Taiwan, or I went to China, or when I'm in Taiwan now, is they think I am from China because I couldn't say Taiwanese. I couldn't speak Taiwanese. And they can hear my tones like from the China. It's like from China. It's not Taiwanese tone. But when I went to China to visit my relatives there, because I have a lot of relatives there, and they think, oh, you are from Taiwan, because your tone is Taiwan's tone. It's not China's tone. So it's like, where am I? But when I'm here, United States, people think I'm from Asia. They will ask me, where do I come from? I say, oh. So that make me wonder, should I say Taiwan or should I say China? Because I'm a Chinese, but the political make me very confused. So, so that's how I feel now. Yeah.
Yeah, working through it can be kind of tough. So you did mention your experiences in the education system in Taiwan. Do you remember any of the subjects that interested you in school or the activities that you participated in while you were in school in Taiwan?
No, because I was in a private school and it's very, very competitive. I have to pass the exam to enter the kindergarten. And when the kindergarten went to the elementary, I had to pass another exam. And from the elementary to middle school, another exam. So it's all examination. It's like this ship, you know? So it's very competitive. And for me, it's like test every day. So it's my experience because I went to private school. But when I was in college, my other friend, they didn't grow up in Taipei or they didn't go to private school. Their childhoods were so free. It was not like mine. Yeah, so I didn't really like anything. While I was young, everything kind of, for me, it's kind of like being pushed. Yeah, but I like to draw, but it's a hobby. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, so, yeah, but because the examination, we have entrance examination toward the end, all those unimportant subject. The school just say, oh, just we don't have to go to those subjects. Just science, math, English, Chinese, history, geography, all those subjects. Yeah. So yeah, that's it.
And then you mentioned that you had two siblings growing up.
Yeah.
Can you recall any memories about them growing up?
Yeah, they are my elder brother, two brothers. I'm the youngest one. So they are kind of like, one is 4 years older than me, the other is 6 years older than me. And So when I was little, we barely played together. Yeah, because they are too old. and they are boys. So we didn't, there's no, nothing's overlap between us. But they love me for sure. If I was bullied, I still remember one time I was bullied at school, and my elder brother just went to my school to warn the boy. that's great. And he is in California now, my elder brother. So we're still very close, We're very close. I and my elder brother are very close. Yeah. That's interesting. Yeah.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Would you mind sharing some of the stories from your parents?
Oh, yes. As I say, they both were born in China. And my father, he is the only one went to Taiwan in his family. Yeah, and so that's very sad. Because he joined the military, and he was a Navy. So it's, yeah, but later he went to an organization. It's more secret. At that time, but my father was in Ohio State University to get his double E degree, and master of double E, and then he went back to Taiwan to serve the government. And so but my mom is the only child in her family. And actually, their parents is my grandparents know each other. Yeah, so when my dad went to Taiwan, when my mom's family went to Taiwan, the whole family went to Taiwan, they lived in my father's house for a while, then they keep going. They try to convince my father's father, my grandfather, this grandfather convinced that grandfather to go to Taiwan with them, but my father's father didn't accept it. So the whole family stayed in China. Yeah, so that's why all my father's side relatives are still in China. Yeah, that's there. Then they somehow met in Taiwan and on the street. That's good. And they just try their best to raise me and my brothers. And the reason I'm here is because my father, and he's still very alert about the war. And I think it's a trauma to him. And he sometimes, even now, if somebody knocked the door, that would scare him. Because the Second World War, all those experience, they were hiding the Japanese soldier, all those stuff that happened in his childhood. So that happened when he was a kid. So that was in his heart. It's still impacting a lot. And me and my elder brother are here because the theory my father has is don't put all the eggs in one nest. He is like alert to maybe something will happen again. So he doesn't want everybody suffer. He hoped maybe I and my brother can be here. And so it's like spray. It's like the investment. You don't invest all your money to one account. Spray the risk. Reduce the risk.
Yeah, thank you for sharing those stories about your parents. Could you speak a little bit more about your father's experience going to the US, immigrating here for his education, and then coming back to China, to Taiwan?
Oh, no. My father went to OSU only for two years for his master's degree. Then he went back to Taiwan to serve the Taiwan's government. Yeah, and he was trained in Hawaii, something like that. When he was in the OSU, the tuition is paid by the government. Yeah, so everything is that. He didn't say that too much. He said, because he was poor at that time, because the living expense is limited, he wants to support the family in Taiwan. So he only saved a little, just few for himself. So he said he ate chicken every day because chicken is the cheapest at that time. So that's why now he doesn't want to eat any more chicken. Yeah, so he saved the money for us while he was here. And he just do his best, study. Then in the shortest time, he just spent, I don't know how long, because I was little, but maybe it's one or 1.5 years, and he didn't go to the graduation. He just rushed back to Taiwan. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for sharing those stories. Can you talk a little bit more about the family values that you were brought up in, that your parents emphasized?
My family value? Oh, that's a big one. I think they just want us to do our best. Yeah, and I think just because my father, you can say he's an immigrant from China to Taiwan. So he started everything from zero. And that's why he also think we should have a ability to support ourselves in the future. That's why he asks us we have to study, and then we have, yeah, something like that. They compare to some other people, other parents, they gave us a lot of freedom. Yeah, so I think that's good. So we treat each other like friends. Yeah, so it's not like other family I know. It's very, the traditional Chinese family is very like, how to say that? It's like, you have to totally obey me, just do this, do that, just do what I say. Yeah, my parents are not like that. Yeah, so that's good.
I see. And did your parents bring you up with any spirituality or religion as a kid?
Oh yeah, I went to church when I was in kindergarten, and with my mom. But at that time for me, God to me is like more like a friend. I can talk to him, I can do anything. And then I went to Wesley Girls High School. It's a boarding school in Taiwan. And it's a Christian boarding school. So we had to go to the Christian class once a week. And I think I believed in God, not until I went to the Christian, the Wesley Girls High School, not until I graduated from there. It's more like, because the speakers would ask us, why do you believe God? Why do you believe God? then he would explain, why do you have to believe God? But what left in my mind at that time was, why do you believe in God? And I have been, they ask different speakers, they all ask the same question for 3 years. So when I went to college, it's very interesting. I just pray to God. I told him, okay, I'm going to leave you, but bring me back in the future. And I'm going to say bye to you now, and I'm going to enjoy my college. I don't want to live I want to live a life just by myself. And it's very, God is humor. God is really nice to me. He led me to enjoy my life, but it's suffer. It's really suffer. I had a lot of things. I have something. And so when I got married, and when my first son was born, I was baptized when I was in Arizona State University. When I studied there, and I went back to Taiwan to baptize. And then I decided, okay, I want to be baptized. But my life didn't change. I still live my own life. I didn't treat God as God. Not until my first one was born, a sister, just very nice, a sister in our church, a church friend was very nice. She went to my house once a week. We did the Bible study together. And from that time, I started to treat God as God. Yeah, that influenced me a lot. That also impacted my artworks. Yeah.
Interesting. Do you remember any of the sorts of foods that you remember eating a lot in your childhood? Your favorite dish you enjoyed?
I love fish and papaya. I even remember I told my mom, I want to marry a person. I want to marry a fisherman, but I also want to marry a person who had papaya. I really love those two, but now it's different. Now I don't like fish. I think our taste change. Yeah. Or the fish here is not so fresh as Taiwan. So yeah.
And do you remember, or could you take us a little bit again more through your neighborhood? Your childhood friends and the kind of activities that you did for fun?
The neighborhood? Because I live in an apartment. So it's basically, and there's no other kids. I think because we all live in there. It's not like here you can just say hi to your neighbor. We have neighbors, but we always say hi. But like I say, my childhood, most of the time is study. Yeah, and I take the school bus, go to school. And so my childhood life is very limited. And yeah, the only thing I remember is like maybe summer or sometime we will just hang out together, that's it. And we call each other. At that time, we don't have cell phone. We just call each other, chat. Yeah, it's kind of a boring, really. It's a boring childhood.
Wow. But you did have drawing with you.
What?
Drawing, art.
Yeah, I took drawing class with that happened when I was in high school. Yeah, but I still remember I had an uncle, my mother's cousin. He taught me how to draw horse. And that's why I started to love horse at that time. And that inspired me because the horse is so free. I love the freedom. Yeah, so I'm very lucky. And when I was in college, I had another uncle. It's very rare in Taiwan. He had a horse ranch. So I would skip my class, go to there to riding horse. And my father figured that out, and he just told me, "Come here, I have something to tell you." He said, "The Chinese saying, the horse and music and something will disturb you. It's an old saying, and old Chinese saying." And she said, "Don't go to there too often because that will interrupt your study." I said, "Oh, okay." Then my uncle knows that. He said, "No, don't come. I don't want your father to blame on me." So I didn't skip my class, went to write, and then slowly and I graduated and started work. So yeah. That's a good memory, riding horses. Yeah.
That's so fun.
Yeah.
You said that you immigrated to the US when you were 22.
1989. Yeah.
So did you attend a university or college before moving to the US?
Yes, I went to a three-year college in Taiwan. So since it's a three-year, I couldn't take master directly here. So there are many credits I need to make up. So that's why I went to, it took me 2 years at Arizona State University, yeah, to get a bachelor degree. And once I graduated, I just got married. So, and I applied a graduate school here. It's business graduate school. But while I was waiting for the school start, I found I was pregnant. So it's, okay. So my husband, I said, "No, don't push yourself too hard. Just relax." Yeah. Something like that.
Life takes a turn. Can you speak a little bit more about attending this three-year university back home?
It's a three-year university. It's all girls at that time. It's all female, and it's a high mountain, and it's weird. We have to wear uniform, and the uniform is skirt. It's tiny skirt, and we have to wear high heel shoes to climbing the hundreds of stairs to our school. That time. Yeah, my major is business, was international business. Yeah, at that time, I don't remember what the teacher told me, what the professor said. I only enjoy hanging out with my friend. Yeah, because it's kind of a free in college, much more free than in high school. Yeah, that's that.
Do you recall any of the activities or extracurriculars that you did in college?
Activities. In our generation, we will go to dance at nighttime, just like nightclub here, but it's not really nightclub here. Just the college students, we rent a place to dance, have DJs, something like that. Yeah. So, yeah, that's the And sometimes, because we are girls' school, sometimes the other boys in different university will invite our class, see who wants to join them. They will have some activities and to go to camp or hiking, something like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's the activities in my generation, but now it's much different.
Wow. And then after graduating, you moved to the US. How and why did it happen?
Yeah, it's like what I said, my dad doesn't want us to put all the eggs in one nest. And on the other side, at that time, a lot of people graduate from college, they just went to United States to have to pursue a better education here. Yeah, that's a trend in my generation. And as I said, the education system trained us to obey, not critical thinking. Yeah, we obey, but no critical thinking. So I didn't know what I want to do. It's just follow the trend. Yeah, so I had no clue. I said, oh, better education. Okay, then I applied to business school since my major was business. I didn't care if I like business because I just followed the trend. Yeah, follow everybody. Mm-hmm.
Did any of your family move with you when you went to the US?
Just me. Yeah. Then later, my elder brother came to California because his fiance was there. They immigrated to California. So once they got married, they engaged, they got married, they just moved. My brother just moved, immigrated to US too. Yeah.
Yeah. Moving to an entirely new country by yourself, it just seems so daunting. Can you recall any of the other challenges that you faced?
Other child?
Any of the challenges?
Challenges. Oh, a lot of the challenges. I still remember in business class, the professor said campbell. I don't know what's campbell. Because in Taiwan, in my generation, it's not so international in Taiwan, but now it's so, if you go to Taiwan now, it's all kinds of products in the supermarkets. But when I was young, most of the products are it's made in Taiwan, not just a little import products. So I didn't know campbell. So when they, because in business school, there are some business study, there are some, just like a case, some cases that the professors may say, campbell, what's campbell? Something like that is too new. Everything I have to learn from zero, and it's kind of hard, especially they are, and I had to study psychology. It drove me crazy because when you open the book, it's all vocabularies. It's so it's so slow. When I studied, for me, it's so slow to read one chapter to study. You know, it's horrible. Even the Chinese history, I think, oh, I have to take a history class. Let me take a Chinese art history. I thought, oh, that'd be easy, I know. Turn out it's so hard because they translate all the Chinese name to English and I don't know who they are because it's translated. So it's totally different. So I had no clue what you are talking about. Yeah. So it's fun because at that time I had a roommate, my roommates from Taiwan, and we had a group of girls stay together, and we would go to grocery at midnight or 2 a.m. It's fun. So then after, and we don't have a car. We didn't have a car at that time. Only one girl had a car because her sister was there and her sister gave her the car. So she would drive us to the supermarket and at midnight or 2 a.m. Oh yeah, that's good memories.
That's nice. That's nice that you had community.
Yeah, that's great.
But did you feel any other kind of cultural shocks moving to the US and adjusting to how life is here?
I think the cultural shock is like just little by little. And I think that applies to everybody. When we were young, it's easier to adapt. But once we graduate from college, then we came to here, it will be harder for us. Our tongues couldn't do the your way. So there are a lot of things we couldn't, words I still cannot pronounce right. And cultural shock, it's more like, for me, it's more learning. Yeah, more learning this culture. Yeah, we are very open to adapt, to learn new things. And yeah, I think it's more like that. It's the shock. Maybe it's I think in college life is more fun to observe different people and to see all those American pretty girls, to look at them, to see how they behave. To all those stuff for me is fresh, it's new. And what they would do seems very free. And think, oh, that's great. Some things like the TV show we saw, the drama we saw in Taiwan from the TV. And it's fun, just something like that. Yeah, I think it's most of that while I was in college, the experience was pretty good, but recently was not good. That's why, because maybe you will ask me more questions later. I won't say now.
Nice working in for the suspense. So you mentioned like having roommates who are also from Taiwan and like the fun grocery trips that you had at midnight. Do you have any other like really special memories attached to college or defining moments that you had?
Oh, maybe not. Maybe something will pop up later. I'm old, it's hard to think now. Yeah, I think, yeah, it's fun. I still remember because, as I mentioned, I didn't have a car at that time. So I was biking to school. And some class was at 7:40 a.m. So for me, it's like, yeah. See, I still remember. So even in Arizona, in winter, it's so cold. You know, riding bike is so cold. When you pass, because they will water the plants at midnight, so the the water become is ice. You know, it's become ice. When I'm riding the bike at 7 o'clock, it's still ice. So it's, and your hands are so cold. It's riding bikes today. To have class. Yeah, it's a fun experience. And since I was riding bike, I learned how to ride very, very slow. Riding bike, just like I say, all those Americans are walking because they drove to school. And so they walk around the campus. But we ride bikes. So if they walk in front of us, I could ride very slow to behind them. Yeah, it's something like that. And if the girl didn't have time to take us to grocery, there was a grocery store called IGA. I don't know if, I think we don't have it in Houston. And we would like to do some grocery, even the gallon milk. I could put, I don't have a basket, but I just put it on the handle of the bicycle, the back, ride it home. it's interesting experience. And I remember the first semester, I lived in the second floor because the Chinese, the Taiwan Students Association of ASU, they asked them help me to rent an apartment. And it's very nice. They rent one, but it's the second floor. So I have to move my bike to the second floor every time when I was home. Yeah. So it's, but I was young, so no problem. That's fun. Yeah.
That's nice that you had all of that with you. And the bike story, I bike to campus. As well, I can kind of relate to all of the endurances that the city can put you through on a bike. You mentioned that you interacted with the Taiwanese Student Association at ASU. Can you speak a little bit more about a little bit about that and any of the other extracurriculars or clubs that you found on campus, or any kind of like places where you found community while you were in
college? They would have same generation stuff. They would have the dancing party. or go to picnic, something like that. Maybe just once a year. Yeah, and we didn't have any community unless church, but at that time I didn't go to church very often, and just my roommates and some friends, we just hang out together. Yeah, because most of the time we are studying, as I say, it's so hard, us the English is so hard for us, so the reading, the English reading, there's so many vocabularies, so we had to spend much more time than the Americans to prepare ourselves. Yeah.
You mentioned that you took this Chinese art history class when you were in college. How else did you explore art at ASU?
That art history class, simply just because I think it's related to Chinese. So I think that's, that'd be easy. So, but it's not. Because I didn't know all those names. It's even harder for me to remember how to spell them. Or how, yeah, it's. Yeah, that's it.
So did you have drawing or painting or sculpting? Like, did you do any of that in the free time while you were in college?
No.
Uh-huh. But it later came back with you. So you graduated from ASU with a BA in finance, and you were in Arizona for quite a while. Can you explain what life was like there after graduating?
Oh, once I graduated, I moved to Cincinnati because I was engaged. Once I, my husband is my, went to the same kindergarten with me. We were in the same private school, but we were buddy buddies. We were good friends, not boyfriend, girlfriend. Yeah, and so it's like one semester before I graduated, I think it's a summer. I graduated winter, so yeah, spring semester, not the fall semester after. So it's like he called me, and because he had to go to the military when he graduated in Taiwan. That in my generation, every man graduate from college, they had to serve in the military for 2 years. And by that time, I was in Arizona State University. And when he went to Cincinnati, he called me one day. He found my number because we were good friends. And he found my number. He got my number. He called me. He said, "Oh, so happy." We chat for, I think, 5 hours. Yeah. So, and at that time, and he invited me to go to Cincinnati because he and his friends were going to Niagara Falls. I think, oh, that they were going to drive to there. He said, but actually when he called me, I just finished a relationship and I was very down. So he invited me to visit him and then we can go to Niagara Falls together. And after the Niagara Falls trip, he will go back to Taiwan. And yeah, and I will go back to Arizona. And his mother was, my mother-in-law arranged a lot of meeting, not like, there's a lot of matchmakers for, went to his mom and said like introduced girls to him. And so he said, oh, let's go to Niagara Falls together and with his friends. Then he had to go to Taiwan. But then after the trip, he asked, he was thinking, do you think we two can be together? So I don't have to go to all those matchmakers, make the appointment to meet all those girls because they are all unknown. The risk is high. He asked me to think about it, and it's like business in any way. So for me, and I said, yeah, think about it, see if we can be together, if we can try. And so when I went to the airport, he asked me, do you have the answer? I said, okay, maybe we can try. Yeah, if the marriage is the destination, is the fate, then maybe we can try because we know each other for so long. We knew each other. We were good friends. And it's kind of like when Harry met Sarah, you know, It's so it's kind of like that. And you say, okay, let's try. Yeah, so then half a year later, we went back to Taiwan to engage. Then we went to here, we went to United States. At that time, my brother was in Chicago, so we got married in Chicago. Yeah.
I love that. That's a really sweet story about how y'all reconnected.
Yeah.
So moving on to Houston, when did you move to Houston? What year? And where were you in your life when that all happened?
We moved to Houston 1994 because my husband got his first job here. And at that time, I was a 100% mom, housewife, to take care of the kids. At that time, my first boy was 4 years old. My younger one is 1 year old. So I was totally devoted to take care of them. Yeah.
What were your impressions that you had of Houston before you came over?
What's the word?
What were the impressions? Like, what did you think of
hot.
Before coming?
Hot. So hot. First impression. I still remember we moved here in winter time. Our whole family is wearing shorts and short sleeves. And then we saw some people wear leather jackets. So we think, what happened to them? Why do they wear leather jackets? So, it's so hot here, and I still remember the first summer here. My son, when they got off the car, they couldn't open their eyes. It's like all like this. It's so hot. Yeah, the first impression is hot, and the second impression is flat. It's so flat. No mountain, no valley. Yeah.
So coming to Houston as a full-time mom, what was that experience like?
It's that's what I have to do. I think it's hard for me at that time because I have two boys. Boys are totally different from girls. Boys are full of energy. then they fight, they scream. It's like whole day. Yeah, so, but I'm very blessed when we came here to visit here, and we are looking for schools for my son, my first one, and they couldn't, because it's hard for them to get a preschool here at that time, and we went to a private school. The principal was so nice. She knew there are a lot of people on waiting list, but she knew we just came to look for the school, and she just saved a spot for us. She just saved the spot. She said, as long as you can, your son can get that spot. She is so nice. Yeah. And so it's Mother's Day out. It's not preschool, it's Mother's Day out. And it's so different, the because my son, the preschool he went in Cincinnati, that preschool belonged to the UC, University of Cincinnati. So the teachers over there are professor and graduate students. And so the philosophy is very different from here. They taught them daily life. It's totally different. They learn from play. Yeah, something like that. But here, the private school we went is more academic. So I still remember, I always talk to my son in Chinese at home. So the first day when he came back from the Mother's Day out, he told me, "Mom, they are all older than me." Yeah, he felt he was lost. He didn't know anything. So that was a pressure on me. So I don't want him to feel, because he was in a new environment. I hope he can make some friends. So So I think that's very different from here. It's very different from Cincinnati. Yeah, it's more city. Yeah.
I definitely get that from living in Houston. Moving on a little bit more about your career, how did you decide to pursue your current career as an artist? What sparked you?
Oh, that's very, very important because, as I mentioned, I say goodbye to God, right? And as I pray, he took me back. And I had a very good fellowship in church here. We were reading a book at that time. I think that book was very popular. It's called A Purpose-Driven Life. So I read the book, and actually I had a 1-on-1 with a friend, used that book to have 1-on-1. So it's basically like we read one chapter every week. And so since I was reading the book, I started to pray. And I ask, what's the purpose of my life? Yeah, and even though at that time my kids were young, and I prayed for 2 years. And God used different things, let me see. I can go to Glassell Art School to take art class. It's God let me see. It's time. I should have action. It's like to equip myself if I want to go learn art. It's time, not just thinking. Yeah. In the Bible says like the lazy people can only adore other people, but hardworking people can enjoy the accomplishment. Yeah, so it's the purpose-driven life and the Bible and another book. Oh, I have to backward, because when my kids were in the private school, I helped the teachers to decorate their school. That's why I think I should take the art class, because the teacher at first was one teacher. He is a man. He was teaching science. He had no clue how to decorate his classroom. So I just went to help him, and then later on another man teacher didn't know how to decorate his room. And I said, okay, let me help you too. And turn around the whole way. I decorated the whole hallway at that school. So I think, oh, that's really fun. I really enjoy to help the teacher to decorate their classroom, the hallway. I really enjoy it. I love it. And it all happened at the same time. I decorated the classroom. I was reading The Purpose-Driven Life. And all those stuff happened at the same period of time. So then I realized, oh, it's time I should, after the 2 years, I know it's time God's using the Bible verse and different book tell me it's time you should step out. Yeah, so not just sit there thinking, oh, I like it. You should to take class. And I was debating, should I take the class at Glassell Art School or HBU, Houston Baptist University? And I went to talk the administrator in HBU because my major was not art. So there are a lot of credits, unnecessary credits I have to make up. It's like a science, history, something, it's not related to art. I have to take those classes. But I told them, I graduated from Arizona State University. And why do I have to take those classes? And they just told me, yeah, you have to, it's based on the policy. I said, okay. But you know, my background for me is like, oh, study, you know, that still grabbed me. And that time I was wondering, I still remember, it's a very important thing for to me to make that decision, is like which school I should go. Yeah, and I remember I was devotion. And I was thinking, God won't tell me from the Bible, you should go to Glassell or HBU, right? So then I just say, oh, you let me know what to do. And at that time, I just called my very good friend in Taiwan. She's my very good friend. I would call her once a while. And I just called her that day and we just chat. And her husband was a professor. And architect, he was teaching at a college. And I didn't know he was home. And my friend just led me to talk with her husband. And her husband didn't tell me what school I should go, but he just asked me some questions. And then I realized, yes, I should go to Glassell instead of HBU. Yeah, so it's very clear. Yeah, that's how it worked.
That's nice. I liked how all of that kind of happened at once and sparked that decision. Can you speak a little bit more about your experiences in the Glassell School, especially the block program? Because it seems really intensive.
Yeah, it is. It took me how many years? More than 10 years to get a certificate. Because they need 69 credits to get a certificate. And my kids were little at that time. So I could only take 3 credits, one class. 3 credits, one semester. That's why it took me so long. And when my sons can drive, then I started to take one more. But yeah, so the most class I took is like 3 to the end. When my younger one he can drive by himself. Actually, when he, yeah, maybe when he went to college, I took three classes because, I think three is a lot. I didn't want to push myself too much. Yeah, I need to do it. And it's very interesting. After I got the certificate, I didn't know what I should do. And one of my instructor, Jay Hill, he encouraged me to try to apply the block program. At that time, block was very new, and it's only 2 years. Yeah, it started by Patrick Palmer, and it was a very new program at that time, and I applied it, and they accepted me. Once I went to the block program, it was very intensive and very helpful. We had 12 people over there. We had, at that time, now they don't have their own studio, but when I was there, we had our own studio. It's great. And everybody's very self-motivated. I think the most important thing is not only block, it's also my husband is so nice to me. He extend our garage to build a workshop for me. Yeah, so I have enough space and I have tools to do my sculpture. It's really helpful. It's like I have a workshop at the back of the garage with air condition. So I can work there from day to night. And in block, every member is like push ourselves. Even though we have different critiquers went to our studio every week is different, but we kind of like push ourselves to have new work every week, almost like that. And everybody, our relationship is very close. We would go to, we will go to our studio, different studios, just like I go to my neighbor's studio. Then we are very open. We just accept all the critiques. Yeah, we critique each other's work when we have during our free time. Yeah, it's very, very helpful and it's very inspiring. It's an excellent experience in my life. Yeah. And at the same time, I took a professional practice because I was still learning. I had no clue what the art world is. So while I was in block, I also took a class Glassell offered. It's called professional practice, as taught by Jay Hill too. And one assignment is like to tell us go to the gallery to introduce ourselves, something like that. Backward a little bit. Since we have our own studio, one of our black mates, she had a friend came from New York to have the to go to the Texas art fair once a year. Somehow the gallerist, all his work was stopped in Shanghai, in China. But the art fair was going to start on Saturday, Friday. And he went to our program. He went to our studios. And the school, the front desk, just opened all our studio door for him because he had no work. All the artwork he had was stuck in Shanghai. So he needs to have some work for the opening. So that's why he went to our broad program to see if there's any work he can have. And he went to my studio and I didn't know that. It's amazing. I was working in my workshop and I just got a phone call at my lunch break at my kitchen. He just introduced himself. He's blah, 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 and he liked my work. He hoped my work can show at the Texas Art Fair. I was shocked. I was like, so I said, what did you say? I said, did you? Because he talks so fast and my English is not so good. So I said, do you want to see my work first? He said, I am in your studio. I'm looking some works. And he won't have three of my works to be in the art fair. And I just told him, can you wait for me? I want to be there. And he said, and I just, after hang up the phone, I just pray, God, what are you doing? It's amazing. And I dropped there, and he told me, I like this, three works. And I asked him, when do you want it? He said, today or tomorrow? I think that's Wednesday. And so he said, if you can deliver today, I have my assistant. He could help you. He can help you. So I didn't wrap my work very well. I just put all my work in my truck. We just drove there to put my work there. And he told me he could give me a pass. And he was so nice. He built a wall for me to have my work there. Yeah. So it's like, so he just told me so the second day, the Thursday, I went to there to install my work. When I finished my installation, I walk out because the convention center is so big. So I just walk around, I saw the Picasso's work, every all those famous artists' work, I said, my work are with them. At the same show place, it's amazing. And because it's different booths, different galleries, anyway. And it's amazing experience. And I didn't expect anything, I still remember it's a Saturday when I was doing my Bible study homework. I got the gallery's text. He told me there was a lady interested in my work. May I send some CV to her? And at that time, I had no experience. My CV just two shows. He didn't know what to say. He just said, can you come to meet her? Maybe you can tell her your work. And I said, okay. And I just went to meet her. And she likes all of them. So she bought all of them. But the interesting thing is the works are still with me. Because he said she didn't live in Texas. I don't remember where she lived. She lived the other states. She said her apartment's small there. And she hoped this work, because she thought this work are very meaningful. She hoped the gallery, the New York gallery, can help her to arrange where to show those works somewhere. But the New York galleries never did that. So he just told me, I just keep those works first. He will arrange that. And he got the money, and he let me save the works, but he didn't do anything. And I couldn't contact the lady. I don't know where she is. So and those three works are still with me. It's sold to her, but there with me. Yeah, so and backward to the class, I took the professional practice because I have the show in the Texas Contemporary Art Fair. Someone saw my work and just the lady bought my work. She introduced me to Cindy Liska, the other galleries in Houston. And because I'm not a very social person, and since the, again, it's our cultural background, homework, we have to do the homework. Since assignment homework, I have to go to gallery to introduce myself. I think, oh, it's homework, I'll do the homework. And Cindy Liska, someone, the lady introduced me to her. I think, I'll just go to her gallery to introduce myself more. And I just made an appointment with her. I didn't mention what kind of appointment it should be because I had no experience. And she didn't expect me to show my work at that appointment. So, and she just met me and I just saw her some pictures of my works. And she was very nice. She said, oh, okay, thank you. And but I think she liked those works. So maybe after 1 month, she contacted me to ask me if I want to join a group exhibition in her gallery. So I said, yeah. So that's my first group experience in a gallery, a group show in her gallery. Yeah.
Wow, I love all of this. Like rise to success that you're recounting while all the while you're in the Glassell School. Can you recall any of like specific mentors or teachers you had at the Glassell School that were kind of influential to your practice?
I think Jay Hill and Charlotte Cosgrove. I still remember the very first day I went to Glassell Art School. When I got off the car, I was thinking, okay, God, let me know what I should learn. Teach me. And as I said, I could only take one class per semester. So I was super slow. And but I enjoy it. My priority is my kids. And then I took a Charlotte's collage. And I figured out I like 3D stuff instead of a drawing and painting. And but my skill is limited. I couldn't make those 3D stuff very well. And she encouraged me, said, why don't you go to take a sculpture class? And Jay is the instructor in sculpture department since then till now. Yeah, and he is really nice and he understands my English. He is very patient. And he's very knowledgeable, very skillful. Yeah, it's like step by step, skill wise, he taught me a lot of stuff. Yeah, it's learning from mistakes and encourage us. He's a very good instructor in Glassell Art School. And yeah, and the other person, he's not in Glassell Art School, but he really inspired me because, as I say, I'm a Christian. He is a Christian. He's a Japanese artist in New York. And he's a great artist in New York. And he even worked for Bush. It's like a culture or something. Yeah, and yes, he's not only a painter, he's also a writer. Yeah, so when he paint, he would meditation, God's word, and let Holy Spirit to lead him to paint. And during the pandemic, he has YouTube to encourage the artist, keep working. It's a very, very positive artist and very encourageable. And his painting, every time I saw his painting, I just cried, so touching. It's abstract, totally abstract, all in colors, but it's really touching. And I really hope mentor, I think most of my works, before I do them, before I make them, what inspired me is from my devotion, from my meditation. Yeah, it's like teaching me, telling me what to do. Yeah, sometimes I even feel when I make some work, it seems I feel God is holding my hand. It's hard to say, but I know because I couldn't make it unless he's helping me.
That's so nice. And you mentioned that you were drawn to 3D art and sculpture through one of your mentors. And I read that a lot of your work, you used acrylic and resin molds. You do welding and woodworking all in your body of work. How did you come about learning these skills and kind of incorporating them into the pieces that you produce?
I think because I want to, I have to, it's, that's why I keep working at sculpture room. It's not only their required class. I see, oh, there's more metalworking, woodworking. They would offer some class like that, but not now. And I would just take those class. Oh, metalworking would more, metal wood, but acrylic is, they just told me to use heating gun. And it's learned by experience. Yeah, and YouTube. And my shoulder has problems, so I'm not very strong. But I love metal work. So I think acrylic is another good substitute. It's like bending, all those stuff. And I made some acrylic work. I think, oh, that's good. I can manipulate it. It's much easier than the metal, because the metal is you have to use torch, make it whole hot and bend it and something like that. And but compared to metal, acrylic is easier for me to do the shape I want, to do the form I want. But acrylic is, the circulation, the air circulation has to be very good. Otherwise, it's dangerous. Yeah, so I love to work with that, but I'm afraid to work with that. Yeah, so it's resin, So it's like, and the woodwork is, they are all learned from mistakes. I think what Jay Hill is good at is like, he asked me, what do I want to make? And he would help me to make that stuff. And from making that work, I learned little by little. Yeah, I think that's important, and to see other people's work, learning what they do. Yeah, and I would go to like Ryzen. I just went to one workshop. It's a very basic workshop. And I know, what character Ryzen has. I play with it. Now, this summer, I took ceramic class because I want to know the character of ceramic, what I can use. So I just made some ceramic work and work with Ryzen. Yeah. So I think the other reason I like to merge different material together is like, because I immigrant to here, it's like merging, right? So how do you merge things together is important. Yeah, something like, and the other reason I like use like driftwood, because I think Mother Nature is most beautiful work. From my point of view, I think all the artworks are copying the nature. For me, it's like here and there, part of it. Yeah. So I think as driftwood is Mother Nature. That's the most beautiful thing. The only thing I can work with it, I it's like go with it, follow the flow. Yeah.
And I also read that you take inspiration from Chinese calligraphy in your work.
Yes.
So can you tell us more about that as well?
Yeah, because there are so many fonts of Chinese calligraphy, and Chinese calligraphy is some of them, a lot of them is based on the form, based on the shape. Yeah, so that's how the Chinese words start. And most of my work, I like to work with the ancient form. There are so many fonts. And the first font is thousands of years ago. Yeah, it's all different. So it's like, for me, it's like, I like to work with that. The other reason is the meaning of it. I like to emphasize the meaning of the word. Yeah, I think it's very important. And I didn't see too many artists do that, but I would choose the words is meaningful to me. And to try to, like the one you see at Young Center, the word means love. Yeah, it's the word is love. Chinese word is love. And there are so many kinds of love. That love is a joyful love. Yeah, so I have different work. It's about the Chinese calligraphy love. Calligraphy art, that means love. Yeah, now I'm working on light or vision, eyes. Yeah, so, or faith. These are all related to my spiritual life. So I think it's important, and I hope I can have some positive impact to the viewers. Yeah.
You mentioned that you grew pretty close to the other artists in the block program and your classes at the Glassell School. How have you maintained like these long-term friendly relationships with local artists and other community organizations around art in Houston?
Yeah, in block program, I have some very close friends. Now we now our studios are in Burmack building. A lot of the block members, now we are in Burmack building in San Jacinto. Do you know there? Yeah, it's that below. Do you know Ingman Gallery? It's next, just Ingman's in, that building was Terrence, Ingman Gallery's owner now. Yeah, so South Main here is next to it. Yeah, it's very close to Ingman Gallery. It's a building, have a lot of artists over there. Yeah. So now, and I have a studio mate. I originally had my own studio, but it's very big. And I think it's kind of a waste because I couldn't work in there. Sculpture is so noisy, dirty. So it's more like my showroom. So I split it with a painter. Yeah. So he's my studio mate. And I have other friends from block, and they are all there now. And some great artists over there, or one of our instructors' studios are there too. So, and another thing is like Cindy Liska, she moved to Georgia, but when I had show with her, like I said, the first group show, I had the show with Anthony Sober and the other two, and now we just, yeah, become friends. And like Patrick Renner, and I took Patrick Renner's class, somehow we became friends again. And yeah, and yeah, just we would go to their show, their exhibitions. Yeah, and Cindy Liska also, there is a artist in Dallas. It's a Japanese artist. He asked Cindy Liska, is there any artist she recommend can have a group exhibition with him in Oaxaca, in Yokohama. And Cindy gave him some list, and I'm blessed he chose me. So I went to Japan with him. I went to Japan, had a show over there. And I didn't know anybody. There are other artists from Houston. And then I realized, oh, he's the owner of the Red Bud Gallery, Gus, and his wife, and other artists. So it's like that. It's, oh, then we all become friends. Yeah, it's very interesting.
Yeah, and as we're about to wrap up, I just want to gather some of your perspectives about art and society. So as much as Houston is one of the most racially and ethnically diverse cities in the US, how do you think artists of minority background are kind of received as compared to other artists in the community?
I really appreciate you asking me this question. This in my mind for a while. You know, Latino have their own community, art community. So is the African American. They have their art community. And what I mean art community is they are some, their artists would get together to have exhibitions, have the galleries or direct curators, all those are Latino or Black American, something like that. But no Asian. Asian society is not like, it doesn't belong to that group. Asian society is more international, more national one. What I mean is the locally. Yeah, it's especially East Asian. Yeah, It's like we all have the same appearance, black hair, skin color. So people, it's like what happened in New York, like COVID. Now people doesn't like Chinese. Yeah, they would hate Japanese. They thought he's Chinese, right? So we all have the same skin color, hair color. Not only that, our language, our writing are the same. See the Chinese words, some of the Japanese words adapt from Chinese. So they have two word systems. So is Korea. Yeah, some is the traditional Chinese words, some is their Korean words. So we are so close in Singapore. Singapore is all Chinese words, the writing part. But we don't have a community to support each other. We don't have like our curators. The artist is here and there. It's not organized. I shouldn't say organized. There is no community for Asian artists in Houston. I really hope there is one, because I'm kind of an emerging artist, so I don't know. I really hope I can contribute something, but I don't know where to start. Now it's kind of frustrating when you saw especially in Glassell, there are a lot of Latinos. Their community are so strong, but I don't know, it's weird. So I don't know, it's because our cultural background or whatever. And I couldn't find one. I really hope we have a community. It's a Asian artist community.
Yeah, and I hope that, you know, having your stories with us at the archives will help you help us kind of form that in Houston as well. So about to wrap up, I wanted to just touch a little bit about your personal life. Could you just quickly share, like, what do you like to do outside of making all these wonderful art pieces?
My life is my personal life. Yeah, I have a very good husband, two good sons. Yeah, all adults now. And when we have time, we would go to visit them. I like to explore different stuff. Like my first son is in New York, so we visit them. My husband and I just go to all the museums. We love to travel, if there is a group, like a travel group, like in Glassell, we have art travel group tour, art tour. We would join them to go to Greece and Paris, to all those places to see all those art. And I and my husband love to travel and to explore the world. Yeah. And the other important thing in my life is my belief. Yeah, that's how I live. That's my value. Yeah.
Wow. And then for my concluding question, what advice would you give future generations, especially those who are pursuing the arts?
Oh. I think the most important thing is to be authentic and to be yourself. And don't forget where you come from. Yeah. Remember to hold the original, don't lost. If you fail, because in the art world, it's very competitive. And holding yourself to pursue it, pursue your goal. Don't let other people discourage you. Yeah. And be authentic to people, to yourself.
Well, thank you, Shang-Yi, for spending this past hour and a half with me. I've felt like really inspired by your journey towards the arts.
Thank you.